At this point, I want to take a brief aside and talk about ways of encoding other types of information besides numbers. We're going to focus on numbers for the rest of this unit, but there are other kinds of information that we want to be able to represent in binary. And I just want to point this out. So one important type of information is textual data. So what you're maybe familiar with as a string from Java, and that's the terminology that we use in C as well. But we need a way to represent text data. The first most widespread format was something called ASCII, which is this one byte code that was developed in the 1960s. So because it had only had one byte per character, there were a maximum of 256 different characters that were representable. This works pretty well for English, but not terribly well for all of the other languages in the world. And so this was, a very American-centric encoding, and has largely, though not completely, been supplanted by something called Unicode now. So this is a multi-byte code that was developed in the 1990s. It had a very ambitious goal of being able to represent all the characters for all the writing systems of the world. To that extent, I believe they're doing quite well. They have over 136,000 characters in the latest standard, supporting all the major languages in the world, as well as a lot of other symbols and math symbols and things like that. There are actually a couple of different Unicode encodings. There are some ones that are primarily fixed width, so UTF-16 and UTF-32. The one that's actually the most popular, though, is actually a variable width format called UTF-8. And the interesting thing about UTF-8 is that as long as you're just using the standard ASCII characters, it's valid in UTF-8 as well. So the first 127 characters in UTF-8, which is, you know, all the standard English characters and symbols, that will be the same in both ASCII and UTF. So it's only sort of once you go beyond those values and you start having these little, once the first bit is not zero anymore, then that means that the character is now a two-character encoding, and so you have to look at two characters. And there are also three- and four-character versions as well. So if there are particular bit values in these higher bits after the first bit, then the number could be. The important point here is that a particular character could be stored using different number of bytes depending on what the character is. So the advantage of Unicode over ASCII, right, is that you can store a lot more characters. The disadvantage, at least with using the variable width format, is that you don't necessarily know how many characters you have if all you know is the number of bytes, because different characters are stored using different number of bytes, and so you actually have to look through the string character by character in order to determine how many characters you have in the string. The other kind of data that we might want, that we will want to be able to represent in binary, are actual programs, so computer code. So this is what's called machine code. This is a binary encoding of an instruction, which includes information about what operation to do, which is called the opcode, and what information for that operation to act on, which is called the operands. These are generally specific to a particular kind of architecture. So for instance, STU is an x86-64 machine. And so programs that are encoded for that architecture generally won't work on computers that have a different architecture. So here is some code in C. Here is what that code gets changed to when we convert it to machine code. So these are the actual byte values, and then here is a textual way of representing those instructions. And we will return to this in much greater detail when we get to module 4 in this program, where we start talking about, or actually module 3, where we start talking about assembly code and machine code.